We got a, I mean, you used to be running collegiate weight rooms. Now you're running private sector. Tim Caron joins the show. We were just talking off air about, the busyness that is life. How did you handle the busyness of going from collegiate? I mean, not just collegiate, but working at West Point and then being like, you know what? I'm just going to go start my own same premise, but for the Gen Pop. Like, frankly, how'd you have the balls to do that?
Well, I think it's more along the lines of when you're looking around a room and you start to think about what is the long play here? What's the end look like for a college strength coach? And you start thinking about how many old strength condition coaches are, like past 50, have past 55. And then you start to look at, like it's the nature of the beast of what the politics and the bureaucracy and, why people get jobs or don't get jobs is sometimes an eye test, sometimes a subjective measurement. So I was kind of like assessing my future. I was getting married. It's kind of like, evaluating, thrusting my now wife into the life of college transitioning.
It
And
sounds like that's a mob, like
well, it
sounds
does.
like a mob lifestyle, right?
But
Like
it's like, and the other things associated with, like the casualties of war, so to speak. It's the families that suffer, right? Because they're gonna have to pick up and move every 3 to 5 years, or they have to make friends and assimilate into the coaching environment, right? So they become friends with the other wives. And it's like, it's great. There's some great people, but that's a lot to ask for your partner. And the other part was, with my other ultimate fear was the reality of what if we have a family and what if, like, I'm the sole, like, breadwinner and one day my boss just decides arbitrarily I am no longer what he's looking for. And I was out of a job. And that scared the shit out of me, to be honest. I was really intimidated by that. And you start thinking about what are my options? What would I have in terms of plan B? If this fell through, what would I do? Like, oh, maybe I could become a high school teacher, whatever. But I didn't want to leave transitioning. So I thought, well, what would I do if I had this on my own terms and I could kind of control my own destiny? And I was just so lucky to have a couple former athletes reach out. And they, at the time, I was thinking about this a lot, and my life was transitioning. Maybe it was burnout, who knows? But they gave me an opportunity of, like, hey, like, we want to recreate our college experience for everybody. And I was like, well, that's pretty cool. That's pretty interesting because I'm sure you get hit up all the time of, hey, can you run me a program? And you're like, yeah, I could, but it's not nearly going to be as effective as what we do in person, as well as, hey, that's time, man. Like, I want to be compensated for that time. And I don't necessarily feel like I'm a lifetime strength coach for you for your beck and call. I have a right and responsibility to servicing my athletes directly in front of me, but you feel this twinge of guilt because it's like, I kind of, I don't know, make a promise to you and give you this great experience, and now it's like you're on your own. So hopefully it was a way to kind of circumvent that guilt or like cut off that, but, when you got into it, man, Justin, it was, you have this like perception, like you yourself right now are probably what, I don't know how many Division I schools there are, but 140, one of 140 people in the entire world, right? Like that's pretty elite and exceptional, right? That's like 0.001%, and that's something to you, and obviously I understand is really unique, and the amount of sacrifice and the time you spent to get there. The second you walk out of that weight room and you walk into setting up your own gym, no one cares, and it's a problem. Like, I think that's a problem because we're competing with entities that aren't quality controlled, and I know we have our like, incestuous like battles, and we're really critical of each other, and I think that's fair. I think we need to do that because it kind of sharpens the sword. But on the other end, on the outside, the bar is set so low. I mean, it is ridiculous. Like, if we think college strength conditioning is bad, the commercial fitness market is atrociously bad. I mean, it's, but you think in your mind, like, I am so superior to everyone out here, like this should be like easy pickings. Like, truth is, no one really knows about us, and no one really cares about us, and no one really has any kind of bearing or understanding that how unique you are and how like exceptional you are at what you do, and you have to earn it, which I think was like a element of like going back to as like an intern, and like every single day they don't care anything about what like or what you learned in your undergrad or what books you read or certification you have. Like, you got to go out there and earn it. And that process to me, I think at that point in my life, I mean, I'm 42 now, so when I started the commercial fitness business, like at my gym allegiance, I was 36. It's kind of a later station of life to kind of start over. But again, it's like almost your second life of like, okay, now I have control over my next 20 to 30 years if I work hard and I'm good. Versus in college, at what point do you kind of just get phased out? Or at what point do you just get aged out? At what point do you kind of, you're not the flavor of the month anymore? Or, you're kind of a casualty of war because we need to make a change and you seem to be the next on the chopping block. Like, all those things are just scary to me. And so here I am. 6 years later, we have three gyms. We service predominantly gym pop, which is another interesting thing to say, right? Because I think one of the areas that you kind of go into it is like, well, I work with athletes and I work with elite level populations, and I only get to work with the higher echelon of performance. And then the reality is they don't really need you outside of here, because a lot of people give it to them for free, and a lot of people beg them to actually, some people pay them to let them train them, you know? And it's like, all right, well, there's a big market out there for gen pop. It's a $1 trillion industry from a health and fitness perspective and supplementation and all those other things. So it's like, all you got to do is just be really good and work hard and be consistent and have good systems in place. And then over time, it starts to materialize, and you just got to be patient, and you got to be like, stick to your guns. And good training is good training, and working hard is working hard. And obviously, you have to team up with people that know how to get your name out there and brand out there and do it in a compelling and interesting way. But that's essentially where I'm at. So I guess the balls to leave was the fear of what is the reality? What's the long play here? Like, what's my exit? And I guess I just bet on myself, and I want to have more control over my own destiny, and just the reality of like looking around at the 55-year-old strength coaches that I think, I don't know, like I think at a certain point, like someone who's at a school for 20 to 30 years, like I didn't aspire to that. Like I look at some of the dynamics those guys or women do in terms of these places forever, the lifers, so to speak. And it seems like they take on all these responsibilities and roles that are not even remotely close to strength, conditioning, or performance anymore, right? Like,
that's a good point.
Janitorial roles, or like, you know, like going to health and wellness meetings, or, you know, doing stuff, or like, you know, the things not even conducive to what you wanted to like be in this in the first place. And I'm like, I don't want that at all. I want to stay close to who I am, and that's coaching, and that's programming, and that's coaching coaches, and all that other stuff. And it's like, okay, well, let me create a business where I can kind of control that. And here we are. And it wasn't easy. I mean, shoot, like, you talk about betting big. The nice thing about Army, they give you a house on post, and I made six figures, and I didn't have any rent, and I didn't have any kids at the time, so it's just saving, right? So I ended up saving about $100,000, which is great. Then you open up a business, and you don't get a salary, and you don't get anything for, I didn't get anything for 18 months. So I basically just plowed through half of my savings. Like, and like, if I didn't have that startup cash to like really push through, because where it's really going to hit the fan is every single day someone's going to go, why don't you just do like a boot camp, or why don't you just do like what was more popular at the time, like HIIT style classes. If that's effective over time, yeah, I would do it, but it's not what I would do with elite level athletes. This is what I do with people who have millions of dollars at stake for their performance. Why would I take any exception for you or alter that mindset? It's not being stubborn or rigid, it's just principle-based training. It's the most effective, most linear path to high performance with minimal injury, you know. And, you know, I think that part, it's like, if I didn't have enough running capital to like burn through that, and I think I would have a lot different perspective off of, like, I need to start making money here quicker because this isn't working out. Or, you know, the same thing when you're interning. Like, I'll do 3-4 internships gladly to get that first college assistant strength coach job. And, you know, your bandwidth and your emotional stamina to go through that really determines whether you're going to make it out, right? So here I am. I don't know if that really answered the question in terms of balls. Mostly fear of what I actually knew was going to be the potential inevitable. Like, and I didn't want that life, and I wanted to have more control.
No, you made a good point, but how did you handle the different type of fear? Like, it's a different, okay, the unknown of what's going to happen, or, hey, you know, you're doing different roles within the university sector, but now you're doing new roles of things that you weren't taught before, like how to find different real estate. I mean, you have three different locations, so are you the property manager? Like, how do you handle that? And then to any of our listeners out there that do run their own facility and they're struggling with it, what do you recommend to them?
Set up within digital or a remote base, or like you're just bootstrapping and finding parks and fields to do stuff. I would say my advice, and this is hopefully the biggest thing I can get across to everyone, is start developing these things now, right? So if you're a college strength coach looking to start a facility, there's no reason why you shouldn't be doing remote based training or doing some getting your platform out there and proving your brand. If you're out there looking to aspire and develop, build your own gym and your personal training at like a Lifetime or Equinox, like build out your roster now. And then when you have that opportunity to transition, like you want to grow into the facility or the role that you have, right? So we opened up a facility with nothing. I mean, we had nothing, Justin. Like I remember like the office over to me, I remember the first person that paid us and we had no idea how to accept payment. Like, and I was like, I have no idea what to do here. Like, That is a bad way to start a business, to be honest, right? But you figure it out and you work through it. I would say, though, to answer that question is start, and then when you're ready for that facility, you can grow into it, right? So we have a very small footprint, and our idea was low overhead and very manageable operating budget. Now, as we start to expand, we can go to a bigger facility, or we can open up another one, right? So it's a different facility with the same footprint and the same kind of ethos. That's kind of a thought process, though, of like, okay, I can take this thing and grow it into something, into a bigger facility, or I can take the thing where I'm doing online or remote-based stuff or training people at like a Lifetime or Equinox or any kind of like big commercial gym, and I can roll that over into opening a facility because you have momentum. We had zero. Like, it was just complete inertia. We had to just completely break this inertia and just plow through and start from nothing. And you're hungry and you want it to work, but, man, it was, again, eating into your savings, a lot more stressful than it had to be. So I'd say to answer your question directly, it's, you know, you don't have to be as blunt and as like aggressive as starting from nothing and just building out and having your back against the wall. It's like, you don't have to do that. And I think now, especially more so than ever, between, you know, online, social media, honestly, all these different platforms where you can do remote-based training, you know, like, and to the point of before, no one gives a shit that I was a college strength coach, one of like 140 people in the world. Like, it doesn't have to be that narrative anymore, right? Like, you're seeing like your platform or a lot of other really good college strength coaches that have 30, 40, even 100,000 followers. Like, their transition to opening up a facility, which hopefully is going to parlay into some sort of monetary value down the road, is going to be a lot easier, right? That's value. That's someone saying, hey, that person brings redeemable value online. You can parlay that into something different and better, which hopefully gives you a little bit more of that, hey, I have a little bit more leverage here in a situation where I'm looking around the room and I have no plan B. Like, if that coach says to me, you're going to run 300-yard shuttles or you're going to do this or else, I have no other option. What do I do? Like, I was hired by Jeff Munkin. I could be fired by Jeff Munkin. If Jeff Munkin decides between that point of hiring and firing that he doesn't like me anymore, I have no other option, right? I had to start from complete zero and scratch. And that was the fear, right, Justin, where it's like, imagine if I had 100,000 followers and I was making six figures as an online strength coach, coaching remote-based athletes. And he says to me, we're going to do these things. And I'm like, well, I don't know if I agree with that. And I have a little bit more backbone. And maybe we have a better discourse because I'm more confident when he's like, hey, it's you, or I'll find someone else and we'll find them. Integrity is a funny thing when you actually have a plan B or backup or a different strategy.
Ooh.
You know, and I think
Dive into that.
But I think that's the thing. We're always putting these corners and boxes and strength and conditioning. And it's so hard, right? Like, it's so hard because, you know, a really good example was, and it's funny because I remember Care called out like that four-way tug of war, right? And this is like an interesting backstory here. So the setup on this, and hopefully this is coming off as like defensive, because I think there's a point of context here where it was interesting. In 2014, we were pretty bad. In 2015, we were notoriously bad. We lost to both Fordham and Yale at Yale. So two FCS losses is pretty much like you should go ahead and polish up that resume and start to look for another job. One of my assistants, Darren Mustin, actually brought up to me, he's like, you know, we got outscored 140 to like 20-something in the fourth quarter in 2014. I was like, no, I didn't. And I was like, it's pretty like substantial like margin or difference, right? And here's academy football, right? We're tough, we're physically trained, we're conditioned, we're going to be the person that can execute better than any other team in the country when it really is like in a high-stress situation and we're just getting our asses handed to us in these like situations. Could be fatigue, it could be a whole bunch of other things. But when you get to it and you present that data and you start to look at that and you go, I think we have a really good training program. I think we really work hard. I think our guys are really tough. What is the actual difference? And you start to play around with ideas and you start to go, okay, well, do we put our guys into, I guess, more stressful situations by having them think when they're tired? Or can we create, like, small-sided games or more competitive things? And it got kind of, like, really outside the box of, like, we just need to rethink everything because if we don't figure this out, we're going to be out of a job. And we presented it to my boss, Jeff Munkin, at the time, and he was like, I didn't know that number, and that's actually pretty alarming that I didn't know that. What are you going to do about it? Like, do we need to run more? Do we need to do more conditioning? I was like, I don't know. I don't think so. I feel like we have enough workload and we have enough data to say that we're conditioned. I would say from the preparedness, from a physiological thing, we're there. But on the other end, it goes into this dynamic of we're probably missing the mark on more of these challenging situation and making our guys think. And there's other little like nuanced things of like you just feel it, like certain days, certain weeks you're just not there, and like Mondays we were always really bad, whatever it was, from a energy feel or a momentum feel. So it's like, what can we do to kind of like change the narrative here and engage our guys more? And they're always on edge and it's always so serious. So started lighting up a little bit and started to do these competitions, and it would be some amazing games. And Darren was really good about like really getting out there. He's got a background in phys ed and like do some things of like just make him think, right? And it was actually it's funny in hindsight how you get these things like back circle. Like, damn, I wish I was there with that. But I was listening to Virginia Sports Performance podcast, where they were talking about like different colors and different things that create this different cognitive and enriching environment. And we were kind of doing that, and it was like, I wish we had a little bit more of the actual context of what that was doing, because it was kind of just bootstrapping and figuring it out. But it has to like manifest into something, or it won't really matter, right? So we're coming up with, where is this going to go to, right? Where is this actually going to go in terms of a vector and reaching some sort of apex? And that's where it kind of came up with, we have kind of four different structures here. So we have like freshman, sophomore, junior, and senior. We have different four different subgroups with them. So we started working out, like, what if we just did a end of the year or end of the off-season competition and just apex into a four-way tug of war? And to be honest, Justin, like, they still do that to this day. Like, it's 7 years since I've been gone, and they're still doing that. They're about to wrap up their off-season to do that again. So what I think about now in terms of your legacy somewhere, and you think about what that actually manifested into in terms of, like, all of a sudden they start beating Navy and they're a 10-win team and start winning CIC. It was like such a far-fetched thing. And I'll tell you this, for myself, to Brett Gertz before me, to the people before me, there's some really good strength conditioning coaches there. And it was a performance thing that was the problem. It was something else. I think it was a culture thing. It was talent, obviously. I think it was a lot of other variables. And whether it was like correlation, causation, or there was just, we started to like get outside of our own heads, stop becoming such high-performance people. But it got to the other situation. This is why I'm going to wrap this point up, because it starts getting off the rails sometimes of like at the end of practice, we're going to start to do competitions. And every day you get solicited, like, hey, let's do something really challenging. Like, I don't know if it's a good idea. Like, I don't really think that's a good idea to do something really taxing at the end of a 24-period practice with full pads. And at that point, like, we got some momentum. And I could say to him confidently, Coach Munkin was like, I don't know if we should do all these things. So, for instance, maybe we don't need to do like a very energy system intensive thing at the end of practice, like, you know, doing something competitive in that way. Like, or maybe we don't need to do a full contact drill at the end of practice, or doing things that you just know are not going to be what we want. It's like the risk reward just simply there. But now it's like continued on. And one of the frustrations with, like, you know, Hess and Connor since I've left, we're always put into this box of we have to do these things, and we're always fighting this battle of, like, you just get so far away from what the original premise was. And I find now, I think back, like, imagine if I just had a little bit more assuredness that I could guarantee that if I fought a good fight and I said, I don't think that's smart, I think that's dumb, I think we shouldn't do that, and I had a backup plan of saying to my wife, like, if my boss fires tomorrow, then we're fine. Like, I have some sort of assurances that I'll still be able to provide and I'll still be able to make a living, but I think I need to fight this fight because it's worth it to protect our athletes. It's worth it to protect the integrity of what we're doing. It's worth it to really make sure that what we're doing is best practice. But the other side of it, you know how the other side of it goes, like where it's like, I don't have another option here. Like, and I get it, this is stupid. This is completely like out of the context of what we should be doing, but I don't really have a leg to stand on. I don't have a plan B, and I don't know what I would do, how to fight that fight. And I get it can kind of go into like different directions, but I would say in that moment where my willingness to fight for things and my willingness to get on the table for things, my willingness to kind of like really say like, no, we're not doing this, I think would be a lot different if I had a lot of what are the things I have now and my confidence to go, I can go out and earn, I can make a living. I didn't know I could make a living until I actually was forced to do it while I was at strength and conditioning. And it's like, I was a strength coach through and through. All of my training, all of my pedagogy, everything I did was intern, assistant, full-time head strength coach. So when you're in this like world, right, and it's a very closed world, and you no one outside of that, you have a lot of fear of the unknown. Like, I didn't know what plan B was, and I didn't know I could make a living. So when you get to these like thresholds of like, should we do this, like, is this worth the fight, is this something that I really need to stand up for, it's kind of on the fringe, you're like, I kind of a cowtail away from this one, I don't want to fight that fight. So you kind of let things, you tolerate things. And I think that part for me, if I could go back to college transitioning and I could look through what I would do differently, I would put some more assurances in there so I'd be more confident to fight the fights that were maybe necessary and protect the athletes I had. And I think we kind of preserved a lot of the things that we should. Like, I would kind of like steer away, I'd get out front, I'm like, nah, I don't think we should do that. Like, I would get proactive on coming up with post-practice competitions that I think would be safer or more effective in that time period, and just say, hey, I already got it planned out, coach, we're good. But instead of being really creative and trying to problem solve or risk management, I would just fight the fight. Like, I'm just like, no, it's fine. Like, I'm not going to tolerate this. I think we need to do a better job of protecting our athletes. And if you don't think I'm the guy to do that anymore, if you think you find someone else who's more of a yes man, that's fine. I have a plan B. I have an exit here. I can go away anytime. But that's the same thing now. It's like, you know, like I find I'm in a situation with I have 600 different bosses who are all paying customers, and they're all telling me every single day, what do you do? But I have a lot more of that social proof and that confidence and that feeling of like, you know what, like push comes to shove, I'm going to do what's right, because I know when it all fails, I still have an opportunity to go out there and earn in other ways. And as long as I'm doing what I feel is right, as well as like from principle standpoint, from what is an efficacy standpoint, from an ethical standpoint, from protecting not only my members or my paying customers, but my employees, like, you know, I have no short-sightedness of like, I don't have to worry about that, because if that would implode or something would go wrong there, like I have confidence I can pick up my pieces and get back to earning in other ways. And I just didn't have that when I was like a more part of this like system of college transitioning. And I think now, I think that's kind of coming full circle. I don't know if you see that a lot at your end. I think you guys are like, you're talking about that on your network. So I think it's more of like a reigning truth for college strength coaches, where it's getting into this like, you can monetize your skill set outside of your team in a very like, not hopefully like intrusive way or like a way that's going to devalue you from your day to day, but you shouldn't have to have this constant battle with, all right, I got to do this or else I don't have a job.
See, that's one of the questions that listening to you talk about, it made me wonder, like, isn't it a little bit of shame on the school for essentially, and shame on like maybe the coaches for wanting to do things that don't make sense and they're allowed to do it, because shame on the school for not having checks and balances to make sure that what the coaches are doing actually makes sense, or B, they're just like, you know what, hey, the coach said it, they're going to do it. Like, isn't that shame on them?
I mean, you look at it, the disparity of wages within college football in general is egregious, right? So if you're paying someone a 10-year contract, like $5 million a year, and the AD is making, I don't know, $500,000, like they're making 10x what they're making, you know, when they're hiring all of their staff, they have a lot of power. And I don't know. I mean, I'm assuming that you took a lot of pride in presenting your resume and your background and your skill set to Townsend. But truth be told, this was probably a network effect that, like, no, you know, such and such said you were good, so I'm going to hire you. Like, I mean, I wasn't asked about my certifications and my education. Like, it didn't matter. Like, I mean, I remember.
Yeah, no, it was like just to make sure that you got it so they don't get fired or they don't get sued.
So the betting and the background check, like, you know, like, oh, such and such, you're good. You're in. Like, oh, like, really? I mean, it's just, there's like an element of like, you know, how really vetted are we versus like even like our comparable athletic training? You know, I think it's a different setup. I think they have a lower potential wage structure because they're not hired by the football coach and they don't have as much leverage. Which is kind of the catch-22 of it all. Like, you know, if I'm going to be a $1 million strength coach, then I'm probably going to have some sort of power imbalance from the rest of the school. Like, the head coach wants me, so you have to pay me this. Versus if I'm hired by the athletic department and the head coach doesn't have that bargaining chip that, well, he's not my guy, then you kind of lose that, right? But do you get a better hiring practice? Do you get a better setup for hiring more vetted, more qualified people? Probably, but what's the exchange of that? Like, I don't know if we want to give up, you know, these seven-figure deals like that we're potentially going to as a profession in exchange for better hiring practices. So it's like, I think it's always going to be stuck in this area of, I kind of want to like disrupt the status quo here, but truth be told, there's a lot of people that can get hired without much criteria or actual really job like credentials. Like, to be a head strength coach at a Division I university overseeing hundreds of million-dollar athletes, as well as staff of like 10 double-digit people and $1 million weight rooms. And I mean, it's, you're like COO of a Fortune 500 corporation with no resume, right? Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's crazy if you think about it. Like, these are like $100 million institutions that are generating so much monetary value. Like, and all your vetting processes, oh, such and such said you were good, or you worked with me at this other school, so I'll hire you. Like, that's crazy, right? Like, you know, if you're going to scale up to, if my business was going to scale up to a multi-million-dollar business tomorrow, I guarantee my investors would say, do we need to have some really experienced people at the C-level status to run this business because it's a corporation now. It's a really big entity. There's a lot of money at stake. There's a lot of things at risk here if we don't put the right people in place. And exchange that for college strength conditioning, like, yeah, no, like, yeah, no, you're, like, I knew a guy who said you were good, so you're in. Like, that just seems ridiculous. And then when he goes into this level of, like, when you're working for that guy who just went on a limb with no background check on whatsoever for you, because quite frankly, the more they actually know about you, probably the less they're interested in you, right? Like, if they know that you have a really strong background and, like, I have two master's degrees and I have multiple certifications, and I would tell an assistant coach, like, that's fucking stupid. I'm not doing that. Like, right? Like, I want you to do this with my defensive guys because that's what we did here, and, you know, like, that's what I want you to do. Like, fuck off. I'm not doing that. That's not part of our plan. Like, that word gets out there, and the more that head coach finds out about it, like, oh, I don't want that kind of guy who's going to fight me on everything. I just want a person who's going to be a good foot soldier. Just, I don't have to worry about during the summer months when I'm on vacation. Like, I don't have to think about that. Like, he's my brigadier general in charge of the troops, that he's just a yes guy. Like, it just all rolls downhill. Like, he's facilitating the plan. And the more you kind of have education and experience and a little bit of backbone, the more you might actually go against that and make that guy's life harder. Unless he's like this very, like, really forward-thinking head coach, and he's like, yeah, I want to be challenged in every single thing because I want to do best practice every single day to protect our guys at a really good institution. But that's not really the case, right? Especially when you're making 10x what the second highest paid person at the university is making. It's almost this, like, level of, like, almost monarchy of, or a dictator. Like, I don't need people to challenge me. I have to maintain the status. I don't ever want to be challenged. And I think until we revisit that, like, actual setup, you're never really going to have that platform to go, this isn't going to be what, like, a European high-performance model is ever going to be. Like, it's always going to be this very hierarchical structure, and, you know, there's top, and then there's a bunch of other, like, people below that, and there's a bunch of people below that, and there's a bunch of people below that, but it all starts there, and then nowhere there. And I think a great litmus of that would be, at the end of a game, if you lose, and let's say we're getting our asses kicked in the fourth quarter, and they're like, I want to talk to the strength coach, and you get up there, like, I was just doing what I was fucking told. You know, like, that's a dynamic that, like, maybe we don't want the blame, but also, too, like, you know, do we need the credit there as well? And we go to this whole other dynamic of, holy shit, man, like, that's a really tough thing to fix, and it's a really systemic thing, and I don't know if it's never going to change until we actually start to revisit the whole entire structure of it. And it pay coaches $10 million, but maybe the athletic director needs to hire directly the strength coach that's a little bit more vetted to challenge maybe abusal of power, or maybe to put, like, safeguards or controls into, you know, these really, like archaic and kind of, like, maybe abusive, well, like, of the responsibility. Like, you know, if you have a coach out there that's just running the guys over the ground for no real reason, or just doing stupid things with no conscious thought, like, that person shouldn't be in place, but who's going to say anything? Right? And I think that's the problem. Where in my world, and this is something too in terms of, I guess I wanted that, like, objectiveness of it, where it's, there's two reasons why I'll objectively lose someone. If they get hurt or they don't get better. Which is all I really wanted to be evaluated on in college strength conditioning, right? Like, our injury reports are great, performance is great, but I don't really like you. I could lose my job tomorrow. Here,
unbelievable, right?
Yeah, but here, yeah, there's a subjective element. I didn't really like the coach. He wasn't very charismatic, or he wasn't fun, or he didn't really talk to me that much. But you can't argue that if you don't get hurt and you get better, it's pretty hard to leave that place, right? And, you know, that first line of, like, the subjective element and getting past that initial barrier of whatever it is that person's looking for from a commercial fitness model. But over time, as the dust settles, if you're not getting hurt and you're getting better month over month, year over year, I'd have a hard time to say that you should leave this place, right? Because you're getting good results. If I could have a good financial planner that makes me more money and doesn't lose ever and doesn't take risky investments, then, hey, man, I'm probably going to keep that guy. As if he's just this guy with high-functioning Asperger's who doesn't talk to me, I don't really care. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't care. Like, it doesn't matter to me. Objectively, get the job done. In college transition, like, you never really evaluated on that. I've never had, like, a performance review of, like, damn, man, like, injury reports look great, or performance is great. Like, this is awesome, man. Like, I always got a really good rapport with my athletes. Hence, like, I opened up a business with two of them. So, I was keen on that. Like, you know, play the political game of not, like, overly being nice to your athletes, holding them accountable, but having a good relationship with them. don't abuse that relationship, don't overstep. But my athletes always gave me a glowing appraisal because that was the one thing that you could never question me on. And like here in this setting, like I'm evaluated in a much higher objective thing, and I can look at my P&Ls every single month and say, all right, we're going in the right direction because objectively we're doing the right things, and I'm tracking attendance and I'm tracking performance on force plates and all these other things to hold me to that standard. And I know that if I'm missing the mark on those areas, if people stop showing up, probably means they're not getting good results or they're getting hurt. If people stop showing up because they don't like what we're doing and they don't agree with what we're doing, I have objectivity and really just a measure what matters type of approach from OKR's perspective to say, yeah, we're going in the right direction. And the 30 coaches that I have working for me, I can give them confidence in our plan because it's working. We're in college transition, and you go into your staff every year like, yeah, just I don't know if we're objectively being evaluated. I think we're kind of getting this objective mark, which I think is frustrating and sometimes infuriating, and I don't know if that's going to change anytime soon. I'm kind of rambling at this point because a lot of these thoughts are popping in my head. I'm getting a lot of nostalgia here, but you know, I'm thankful for the objectivity I have now, and I think now back, like, I wish we had this when I was in college. I wish I could be more focused on that. I wish I had more of the awareness or a little bit more of the, I guess, the worldliness to go, what would I do in terms of looking at this as a business and how could I structure this in terms of like objectively and looking at it from a key results perspective or like a daily, like what's a really good day, right? And how do I evaluate a good day and then fractal out to a good week, a good month, a good year and say, we're doing our job and we're doing a really good job. And yeah, maybe we're not like in favor of the coach at this point because he's in a tough spot. He's got a lot of pressure on him and something about me is just not striking him as the guy he wants anymore. And you get, well, maybe you're at the risk of getting fired, but I can walk away with my held high because objectively I was asked to do this job and then I was going forward in the right direction. It just didn't work out from a synchronous of like relationship with your coach. And I think I can live with that. But now it's like, I don't have to worry about that as much anymore.
As you're, you know, kind of going down memory lane, how would you pay it forward to those that are, you know, listeners right now that they do have the ability to change it because they are a high performance director, they have the assistant director title, and they're going to try to chip away at it? What would be your piece of advice to help evaluate and further strength coaches' careers in the college setting?
Have a really good job description. I think that is one of the most underrated things I've learned since I've gotten out of college transition. Because here's the truth, Justin, where I look at now my employees, and I'm thinking whether I need to give them a raise or an increase in title or something where they are going to get more, right? We do a lot of continuing education allowance, we do PTO, we do benefits. How do I evaluate that? And you think in the back of your mind, how do they do this in college, right? Like, and you wanted to say that you had this like super high level thought process of like, yeah, I was super strategic. And a lot of it was just guys who worked for me or volunteered for me at other schools. And I knew they were going to be on time and they're going to be reliable. But I thought now, if I was going to do a cold hire process, like, you know, getting outside of my little circle or my little network, which I have to do a lot now, we hire people I have no idea who they are.
Oof.
Which is, I think it's a great challenge, though, because you cast a wider net. And I'll tell you this, man, I am so much better now because we have such a diversity in people. And I'm not talking about, like, race or gender. I'm talking about, like, personalities and archetypes, and we are so much more of a rich environment because we have this diversity in personality and just backgrounds and all these different things, and we get challenged in so many different ways. The way I can kind of like filter through that is objectively saying, are you meeting the criteria which I set out in the job description? So here in my setting, we have a commercial gym concept where we focus on classes and privates, and the other big thing we want to do is have a standardized screen. Because one of the things that we really want to make sure that we're differentiating ourselves from is having a track that's going to make sure that you get the best results possible without getting hurt. And a large part of that is zeroing in on big correlate risk factors. So having a standardized, inter-rater, reliable screen is a really imperative thing. So I'll tell you, if you're going to say, I want to work collegiate, you're going to have to do three things. You're going to have to be able to coach classes, so be an effective communicator in front of the group. And we have criteria we go through that. You're going to have to coach private, so you have to be able to differentiate between coaching a group versus the one-on-one, which is a lot more intimate, a lot more conversational. It's a lot more, I got to adjust this isn't working out. And then we got to be able to effective at screening, which we utilize a functional screen, we utilize four stack, we utilize these things that I don't know if it's as intuitive as you would think it is, but you look at I scaled out. Like my sample is now 650 people with 30 coaches coaching them, and across three locations. Those are the things from a objectivity, high inter-rater reliability, low human error element that we need to be effective with. And let's say that you have no background in functional movement screen. Let's say that you have no background with coaching classes. You've only done privates and you've never done a screen before. Now it's a rush to say, we got to improve our systems and training processes so you're effective with functional movement screen, force plates, and coaching classes. And then we have to create systems to train you, and we have to create a grading rubric to go, okay, you are now an effective coach up in front of this, and here's some areas to improve upon. We'll give you books and resources, we'll give you courses that we recommend, all these things. And I go back to my staff, and whether you want it or not, I think this kind of like role or title approach of like person who's in charge of nutrition, person who's in charge of sports science, person who's in charge of return to play or working with athletic training and physical therapy, they kind of fall into this kind of like silo, and they go, okay, that's my domain. And I'm going to really lean in on it. And let's say that you have an assistant position, there was a gap there, and you say, okay, that's what we need that person to do. Whether you have that or not, it doesn't matter to me. I think one of the beautiful things about strength conditioning coaching is we have a high utility, we have a high, curiosity about us, that you put me in that role, I'm going to figure it out, I'm going to call other coaches, I'm going to get on SEN, I'm going to find a guy like myself, and I'm going to try to pick that guy's brain as much as I possibly can. And I'm going to become an expert in that quickly. Question would be is, did I clearly define that for you, and I need you to be that expert in that area? And I would say now, looking back, if I was going to go back into college strength conditioning coach, and maybe it's not necessarily that I have to define that role beforehand, but I need to define something for you to be good at or work towards as an assistant strength coach, and then as a director, I need to be clear whether you actually set that as the framework which you're going to be evaluated on, and then from there I can come back retroactively and saying, okay, you can improve upon these areas. And whether you want a promotion or increase in title or increase in rate, like actual compensation, you didn't meet these benchmarks or you did. So that's where the leg is stand on, as opposed to like, oh, you've been here for a year, let's just give you a little bit more money, or, oh, well, shit, you might be going somewhere else, so I need to give you a higher title to keep you around. Like, I'd rather be objective about it, because right now in my situation, I don't have the luxury of 1,000 resumes coming to me and hopefully they're ready made and they can kind of figure it out. You know, I have to have better systems to take someone who's really green or with zero experience or limited experience in certain areas and put them into these three kind of categories of classes, private screens, and then build up their levels or really accentuate type of our focus and education in those areas and evaluate them on that and say, okay, you need to work on this. We need to keep working on that. If you want to be a lead coach or a head coach with us one day, you need to be competent in these areas. And as I go back through college and conditioning, I think it's just kind of like, I got my job at Georgia Tech, and it's like, oh, you do nutrition because you seem like the only one interested in that. Like, awesome. Or at USC, like, you're going to do nutrition, you're going to do sports science, you're going to return to play, you're going to do competitions, you're going to do punishments, you're going to do all data, you're going to do everything. And like, okay, like, sure, yeah, that's fine, I'll gladly do that. And then go to Army, and I'm like, man, I'm looking around at my staff, like, oh, well, Will Greenberg seems really competent in nutrition. Why don't you take that? You know, or Darren Mustin seems really competent in like more competitive aspect, and he seems really interested in that. Okay, you do that. And then Brian Phillips, like, you look really competent and really excited to do the sports science stuff. Great, you do that. I wish now, looking back over that, I could evaluate them better and give them feedback at a higher level, because they were interested in it and they were competent at it, but I don't know if I was effective as a leader to go, I think you're doing a good job. Because they were working really hard and they were coming up with like really innovative things, ways to approach it. I was like, that's cool. Good for you, man. I'm really excited about that. It's better than what we were doing before. So, but I wish I gave a little bit more of like direct feedback of, we can do this better, right? Like, we can lean more on this. I need to objectively evaluate the things that you're doing at a higher level, which now I have to, or I don't make it, or I don't have people who are representing our business and our brand and our company at the level that we need to.
Hey, man, I appreciate that. I think that that's a great place to leave off, because that is a conundrum that so many of us leaders are trying to solve. So, I mean, for anybody that listened to us for the last 40 minutes, man, I appreciate the insights. I mean, I got a ton of great notes here, man. Thank you for what you do. Thank you for continuing to push the field forward. And, man, best of luck as you continue to branch this thing off.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it.
Have a good one.
Congratulations on making it to the end of the video. Why don't you celebrate by watching more videos just like it? You can also help us on our quest to placate the algorithm gods by liking, sharing, subscribing, and commenting. Thank you.